Please pray with me. Dear God, I can't do this without you. God, if there is anything that I have written down that's actually worth listening to, God, I just ask you to open their ears. God, make us hungry and thirsty to know you more, and then satisfy that hunger. Fill us. And let us never be the same. Amen. Rise, and rise again, until lambs become lions. You cannot turn to the kings of your government. You cannot turn to the kings of your industry or commercialism. They will fail you. And the painted gestures of the multimedia complex are only all too willing to slide down to their level for a roll in the mud. We can't turn to them either. So in our moments of need, when we need leadership, when we need a path, when we need to know where to go, who can we turn to? It seems that the only way forward is to turn inward and to find that hidden peace of a higher level, that hidden spark of the divine that is found in all of us, that voice of God pulling on our hearts. And so we must rise. No matter what the people in the world around us, we must rise to a higher level, take the high road, God's road, where we belong. We must rise. But I am not as good as... How many times have we heard some variation of that phrase in our life? I am not as good as they are. I'm not as good a preacher as he is. I'm not as smart as she is. I'm not as strong as he is. I'm not as beautiful as she is. I'm not, we don't make as much money as they do. I am not as good as whatever. There's an old story about a woman named Lady Nancy Astor. She was one of the very first women to ever be seated in the British House of Commons. This is in like 1918. And she was kind of a sassy lady, and she was at this formal dinner one time, and she had remarked to the person sitting next to her, her neighbor, she had remarked that sometimes men can be more conceited than women. And she noticed that some people had overheard her, so she said very loudly, she said, "You know, it is such a shame, it's a pity, that the most intelligent and learned men attach the least importance to their clothes, to the way they dress. Why, right at this table, the most cultivated man in the room has such a messy tie." And then she sat back and watched as every man in the room secretly reached up and adjusted his tie. Who's the most cultivated? Sometimes it seems as though all of life is just a pointless competition. So let's ask the question that so many people think about, but everybody's afraid to ask. Which one of us is the best in this room? Who's the best? How do we know? Okay, maybe not the best. How do I know if I'm better than somebody else? How do I rank myself? How do I know if I'm better than you are? How do I know what is the best job to have in the world? What's the best type of person to marry? What's the best man to be, the woman to be? What is the best school to attend? What's the best type of worship? Which one is the best church? Is it this one? The one across the street? The one up the hill? The one downtown? How do we decide? There's an old story. I don't know if it's true. It's kind of a legend about John Wesley. And it says that John Wesley one night had a dream. And in this dream, John Wesley was ushered to the gates of hell. And standing at the gates, he called down into the pit and said, "Are there any Presbyterians in there?" And out of the pit, he heard the phrase, "Yes," was the answer. He said, "Are there any Methodists in there?" "Yes." "Are there any Baptists or Lutherans?" And for every denomination that John Wesley could come up with, the answer was yes. So John Wesley was very concerned. He was very upset about this. And so then he gets ushered to the gates of heaven. And he's standing at the pearly gates, calling into heaven, into the glorious whatever it's like in heaven. And he says, "Are there any Methodists in there? Any Lutherans, any Episcopalians, any Baptists, any, you know, whatever." Every denomination, the answer is no. No? No? Well, then who is in there? And the answer comes back, "There's only Christians in here." Sometimes these silly competitions that divide us and split us into all these categories, they just don't matter. Today is part one of a four-part series called Rise of the Underdog. For the next month, we are going to be looking at some incredible stories of unlikely heroes that God lifted to incredible heights. And everybody likes an underdog. We love those stories. They make dozens of movies about that every year. But it is time for us to look in the mirror and find the underdog within, and then we can rise to the challenge. Today, I want to talk about useless comparisons and see how that holds us back in our lives. And today, we're going to talk about the story of Jesse and his sons. But before we get to Jesse, we've got to start with Saul. That's our first scripture lesson for today. So here's a little background. You see, the people of Israel, up until this point, they didn't have leaders. They didn't have human leaders at all. They just lived in this community, and they had the rules, and they just had the church, or the temple, and they had this community that they were. And when they went through a crisis or a struggle, a leader would rise up, take control, do whatever was needed to get Israel through that struggle, and then they would let go of their power and go back home. And they would just kind of resume as a community. And those temporary leaders were called judges. The book of the Bible we're in is 1 Samuel. The one right before this book is called Judges. And it's all about those temporary leaders. But Israel wanted a permanent leader. They wanted a human leader who would be in charge all the time. So they told Samuel, who was a prophet, they said, Samuel, go talk to God and get us a king. We talked about this a little bit last week when I said that God told them that this was a really bad idea, that human leaders are going to fail them. But they said, no, go tell God, find us a king. And then we get to chapter 9. And it says, there was a wealthy and influential man named Kish from the tribe of Benjamin. He was the son of Abiel, son of Zeror, son of Bechorah, son of Apia of the tribe of Benjamin. His son Saul was the most handsome man in all of Israel, head and shoulders taller than anyone else in the land. And the first time I read that, all I could think was, man, they are laying it on thick, aren't they, right? He's wealthy, he's influential, he's got all these famous ancestries from this famous lineage, and handsome, just so handsome, the most handsome man in all of Israel, and tall, so tall and big and strong, too, which to us short people is kind of like, come on. What's wrong with being short? And to my shorter brothers and sisters, understand that God lets us grow till we are the perfect height. Some of us just get there a little faster. Alright, so we've got Mr. Tall, Dark, and Handsome, right? And he is the perfect leader. He is exactly what Israel needs. He's perfect. He's exactly what you want to lead. He's got the skills and the wealth and the experience and the strength. And God says to Samuel, there he is. Go get him, anoint him, that's the guy. And so Samuel goes up to Saul and he says, you're going to be king. Now I want to point out Saul's response. It's not in our scripture lesson, but it's in verse 21. And it says, and Saul replied, but I am only from the tribe of Benjamin, the smallest tribe in Israel, and my family is the least important of all the families of that tribe. Why are you talking like this to me? It's kind of interesting. The difference, because at the beginning of the chapter, we heard about this wealthy and influential family with this powerful lineage from the tribe of Benjamin, and he's handsome, and he's tall and strong. But Saul's personal assessment is, no, I'm tiny, I'm nothing, I'm not good enough. Interesting to see the difference between the world, the way the world sees you and the way Saul sees himself. So Saul takes over, and for a little while, things are perfect. For those who are following along in their Bibles, we're in the chapters in between our two scriptures, right? And so Saul takes over, and he's this great warrior king. Israel is like this tiny little nation surrounded by enemies, and Saul is an epic warrior. He raises up Israel's army, and him and his son, Jonathan, they are so good at winning battles. They just start winning battle after battle after battle. They just start destroying all their enemies and protecting Israel. We get to chapter 14, verse 47. It says, now when Saul had secured his grasp on Israel's throne, he fought against his enemies in every direction, against Moab and Ammon and Edom and the kings of Zobah and the Philistines. And wherever he turned, he was victorious. So he's doing a great job. So Saul is so powerful and so strong. He's this mighty warrior. But there was one problem. Saul didn't trust God. He couldn't trust God. And so with every victory, Saul became more and more afraid of losing. He became paranoid about his power. And so there was this one time they were getting ready for battle. And the way they did it is they would always do a big sacrifice to God the night before the battle. But Samuel wasn't there. Samuel's the prophet. He's the one who's supposed to do the ritual. And Saul said, you know what? And he's freaking out. He's losing his mind. He's like, where is Samuel? We've got to do this. You know what? I don't even care if it's done right. I just have to do it, right? I just have to do the sacrifice, get it out of the way so we can go win this battle. So Saul performs the sacrifice himself, which is a huge mistake. Samuel is the one who's supposed to do that, right? So he got in a little bit of trouble there. And then there's another story where God tells him to go destroy the city of Gilgal. He's like, there's this city of Gilgal, they've been hurting your people. Go destroy the city and destroy all the plunder, all the animals of their fields. Don't keep anything for yourself. This is not a raid, this is not plunder. I want you to destroy everything. Now Saul thought to himself, well, why would I do that? Right? Why can't I keep a little bit for myself? I mean, these are perfectly good animals, right? I want to keep all of these. So what he did was he kept the best of the animals, of the sheep and the goats and the cattle. He kept the best for himself. And it's actually, he gets caught. It's actually pretty funny. The prophet Samuel walks up to him and he says, hey, what happened? And Saul says, oh, I took care of it. You know, I got rid of all the plunder. I got rid of all the animals. I did what God asked. And Samuel, this is actually in the Bible. Samuel looks at him and says, oh, yeah? Then what do I hear? Why do I hear sheep? Why do I hear goats? Why do I hear cattle? And so Saul immediately starts backpedaling, right? Because he's been caught with his hand in a cookie jar a little bit. And so he's like, I did that so that we could sacrifice them to God. Yeah, that's it. I kept the animals so that we could sacrifice them to God. Which, no, he didn't. And then we get to chapter 15, verse 22, where Samuel says, what is more pleasing to the Lord? Your burnt offerings and your sacrifices, or your obedience to his voice? Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice. Submission is better than offering the fat of rams. Rebellion is as sinful as witchcraft, and stubbornness is as bad as worshiping idols. Because you have rejected the command of the Lord, he has rejected you as king. Saul couldn't trust God. He couldn't obey God and do what God asked him. And so God rejected him as king. This is so important. Obedience is more important than skill. It's more important than sacrifices or rituals or fear. God calls us to trust him and to obey him with our lives. And so Saul is technically still king, but God has stopped watching over him. God is now looking for a new king. And he sends the prophet Samuel to go find the next king of Israel. Go find someone to take Saul's place. And so now we get to the big story of today, the sons of Jesse. And Samuel shows up at Jesse's house, and God tells him, go to Jesse's house and ask to see his sons. And so Samuel goes to see, and he says, all right, let me see all your sons. And this is in verse 16, verse 6. It says, when they arrived, Samuel took one look at Eliab, and he thought, surely this is the Lord's anointed. So I don't know what this guy looked like, but it must have been very impressive, because Samuel's like, wow, look at that guy. Right, look at those muscles or whatever. You know, he's very impressed by this guy, Eliab. Surely this is the Lord's anointed. And then we get to verse 7, which is the most important verse. It's my favorite verse in the whole passage. But the Lord says to Samuel, don't judge by his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord doesn't see things the way you see them. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. The Lord doesn't see things the way that you see them. That phrase all by itself is amazing. God looks at your life and he sees all the things that you don't see. He sees all the connections and the potential for your life, what you could do in the world. God sees it all. He knows everything about you. The more we get to know God, the more we learn about our Creator and about his character and how much he loves us and he wants what's best for us, the more we learn about God, the more we start to realize that we need to look at our lives through heaven's eyes, through God's eyes, not through our eyes. The priorities of the world are meaningless. All the stuff that we think is so important, right, like how attractive we are, or how nice our clothes are, or how many followers and likes we have on social media, or how many friends we have in the real world, how nice our car is, how many vacations do we get to go on, how many kids do we have, how many grandkids do we have, how much money do we have in our bank account. These standards are just things that the world makes up, and God does not care about them. It just doesn't matter to God. The Lord does not see things the way you see them. It says that people will judge by your outward appearance, but the Lord looks at your heart. The Lord looks at your heart. The world will judge you by your outward appearance. They just will. I wish they didn't. I wish that that's the world we lived in, but that's the world we live in. They will judge you by your outward appearance. They care about what you wear. They care about your haircut and your style and your weight, your makeup, how much stuff you have. The world cares about that stuff a lot. Like, a lot, a lot. But God doesn't. God looks at your heart. And God's opinion is kind of the only one that really matters. And so in case we didn't get the message in that little verse when God says it directly, in case we didn't get that message, he reinforces it with the story. So after Eliab, we go through every single son of Jesse until Jesse says, that's it. Right? He brings in the next son and Samuel goes, ah! And God says, no, not that one. And then they bring in the next one and Samuel gets all excited and God says, no, not that one. They do this 7 times. Did you notice they said the 7 sons of Jesse? As if he doesn't have any more children. All done, no more kids. And Samuel looks at him and says, is this all the sons you have? And Jesse says, yeah, well, there's one more, but he's out with the goats. We didn't even bother to bring him in for this. He's out in the fields watching the goats. Now, it's not in the Bible technically, but you hear the tone, right? Jesse is saying, yeah, sure, there's that one that's not really worth mentioning. His nickname is Afterthought, and he does not matter. He is not important. I forget that he exists. He's not good enough. He does not have the skills. He is not important. I mean, that's just me reading into that phrase. He said, there is still the youngest, but he's out in the fields. I told you that I had 7 sons, but there's another son. So my question is, how many of you have heard something like that in your life? How many of you have heard, I am not good enough. I am not important. I'm not as good as those other ones. You are an afterthought. You are forgotten. You are not valuable. You don't have the skills. You don't measure up. You are not as good as the older brothers. How many of you have heard something like that in your life? For every single one of you in the room who has ever felt less than in your life, this moment is for you. Because when that youngest son walks in the room, God looks at him and says, that one. And his name is David, as in King David. As in David and Goliath, as in the most famous king as Israel has ever had, the man who united all the tribes of Israel into one kingdom. That one. It says in verse 13, so as David stood there among his brothers, picture this, right? Tiny, scrawny little David among his brothers, right? Got all the big brothers around. Samuel took the flask of olive oil that he had brought, and he anointed David with the oil. And the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David from that day on. Notice the contrast. Feel that difference. Saul, famous, wealthy, influential, tall, strong, handsome, but distrustful and disobedient. And then David, small, young, weak, not good enough. The world didn't even count him. He didn't even register. But he was obedient to God. And he trusted God, and that's all he needed. The good news this morning is that God chooses you. That God empowers you. He gives you the power. God doesn't see things the way that you see them. God looks at our hearts, and he sees great things in your life. God can do incredible things in your life. So many times in our life, we hold back. Because we think, I am not as good as they are. Now, there's 2 responses that I can give you as a pastor this morning. I can give you the good cop or the bad cop approach. Right? And the good cop approach goes like this. You say, I'm not as good as they are. And I say, oh, no, yes, you are. Yes, you are. You're the best. You can do anything you put your mind to. You are the best there is. You go get them. You can do it. I know you can. Here's the problem. That's a lie. I can get up here and tell you that you are the best. And it might make you feel good for a second, but you also know deep down that that's just not true. You will always have that nagging doubt in the back of your mind. So here's the bad cop approach. You say, I'm not as good as they are. And I say, of course not. Of course you're not as good as they are in your life, every single area of your life. No matter who you are, there will always be someone someday who is better. Even if you are actually the best. At whatever right now, there will be someone who comes along someday and beats your record. There is always someone better. Get over it. I am not as good as they are. Why does that matter? Why does that matter? Even if you were the best there ever was or ever would be, God's better than you. God could do it better, and he doesn't. He doesn't come down and do our work for us. He chooses to work through us, which shows us that there is no point to comparisons. There are no comparisons. There are no competition. Every role in the kingdom of God is essential. Who cares if somebody else is better than you? Does that mean that you shouldn't do it? Think about it this way. I've got two examples for you. First, I like to preach. You know, I have a lot of fun up here. I really enjoy this part of my ministry. But objectively, there are preachers who are better than I am. There are people out there, and they are awesome. I love listening to some of these guys. If you don't know who they are, let me open your eyes. There's Francis Chan, David Platt, Andy Stanley, Matt Chandler. These guys are so much fun to listen to. They just, when I listen to them, they just draw me in. They know their Bible so well. They've got more experience. They've got better stories. They are brilliant. I love listening. They are better preachers. Does that mean that I should stop preaching? No. Because God doesn't see the world that way. Here's another example that might make a little bit more sense. I'm a father. I love saying that. I became a father about 15 months ago, right? I've got a kid who's a little over a year old. And I love being a father, but objectively, there are people in the world who are better fathers than I am. There are people in the world who are, they're more kind, they have more money, they can provide a nicer life for my son, they can teach him, they're wiser than I am, they're smarter than I am. On every level, they are just objectively better. Does that mean that I'm not his father? Does that mean I should give up? No, because God doesn't see it that way. There are no better preachers. There are no better fathers. There is only willing and unwilling, obedient and disobedient. God doesn't just bless the best of us. He doesn't just like pick whichever ones are best and bless those. No, God blesses those who are willing, who come before God and say, "Here I am, broken as I am. Take my broken efforts. They are not good enough." But God takes it and does something incredible with it. God's love doesn't come down on the best. It comes down on those who answer the call. So if you are called, you are sufficient. And let me tell you, you are called. You have been given the gift of the Holy Spirit to do great things. Let me say that again, because that's great news. You have been given the gift of the Holy Spirit to do great things in the world. God doesn't call those who already know how to do everything. God doesn't call those who know all the answers. God doesn't call the equipped. God equips the calls. First, we say yes to doing God's work in the world, and then he gives us what we need to do God's work in the world. First, we say yes, and then God gives us the ability. He gives us the strength and the confidence. I am not as good as they are. Of course not. That doesn't mean, that should never hold us back. Never let that stop you. God will send you what you need to do his work. Think about King David, the runt of the litter, the forgotten and ignored younger brother that the world said was not enough. I mean, do you really think that David was the one who defeated Goliath? Right? I mean, come on, he didn't have any armor. He just had a sling and a couple of rocks and he beat Goliath. No way, that was God. That was God working through David. It said the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully on David from that day forward. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, the story of David and Goliath, don't worry about it. Go find 1 Samuel chapter 17 and give it a read. It's awesome. It's so exciting to watch God work through David. Now you might be thinking, okay, sure, God gives those who are chosen, those who are called. What if I'm not called? What if I'm not among the chosen, right? God chose David, but what if he didn't choose me? Maybe I'm not supposed to do something. Let's bring it out of the Old Testament. Let's bring it into the modern world. In Acts chapter 1, before Jesus went up into heaven, Jesus told us one last thing. He said, "I'm going to send my Spirit to help you. I'm going to give you my Spirit, and it will help you. All who respond to the call will receive my Spirit." So the same Spirit that worked in King David and all the awesome things he did in his life is the same Spirit that was with Jesus and all the awesome things he did in his life. It's the same Spirit that is in your life right now. God equips those who respond to the call. So will you respond to the call? Now, if you're still hesitating, if you're filled with doubt, remember two things. Number one, God doesn't see the world the way you do. He knows what you can do, and he believes in you. And if your opinion is different than God's, you're the one who's wrong. Right? If God believes in you and you don't believe in yourself, guess what? You're wrong. Because God is right. God is good and he is always right, and God believes in you. God wants to do great things through you and in your life. Second, God will give you the strength you need. More than any training, more than any natural skill, more than anything else in the entire world, this should be what gives us comfort. God is the one who is working through us, so there is no more competition. There is no more comparison. It was what God needed at that time and in that place. You are what God needs in this time and in this place. God is calling. God is knocking on your door. Will you respond?
So how does this matter in our lives?
What's the application? Two things. Number one, listen for God's call in your life. Take off the blinders. Look at your life through heaven's eyes and pray about what God might be able to do through you. Take off the blinders. Take off the restrictions of comparison and the ridiculous, useless mindset of competition. Leave competition for football. All right, that's what it's for. It's fun, but it belongs in football and not in your life. In your life, there are no limitations. Remember, God doesn't see things the way you do. And ask God to open your eyes to the possibilities. Ask God to open your eyes to the potential of what you could do in the world. So first, we must listen. Listen for God's call in your life. Second, we have to respond with obedience. Listen to God's call, respond with obedience. Once you know what God is pulling on your heart to do, do it. No matter how impossible, no matter how overwhelming, respond with obedience. God can work miracles in the world. Why not through you? Why not in your life? I believe with all of my heart that if this congregation would listen for God's will and then respond with obedience, the gates of hell couldn't stop us. We could do incredible things. What if we stopped saying, I am not as good as they are? We started saying, you know what, I am good enough. Try that this week. I want you to take a moment, some point this week, look in the mirror and say these words. Say, I am not as good as they are. And that's okay. Because I am good enough for God, and His opinion is the only one that matters. Let me say that again. I am not as good as they are, and that's okay. I am good enough for God, and God's opinion is the only one that matters to me. Dream with me for a second. If we actually did this, we started listening and responding with obedience, we could solve the drug problem in Ishpeming. We can encourage and inspire the young men to start living up to their responsibilities to their families instead of walking away from women and children that they never bothered to make a commitment to. We can end racial and social inequalities between the people of our community. We can stop looking at our neighbor with eyes of competition. We start looking at our neighbor with eyes of cooperation, working together to make the world a better place. We can end poverty. Just let that sit with you for a second. We can end poverty and heal the disappointment and heartache of unemployment and desperation. Simply put, we can be a light in the darkness if only we would listen and obey. Rise and rise again until lambs become lions. God is, that's a line from a very early line. God is capable of working miracles in our world, and He is calling you to rise up right now in this place using my voice. God is calling you. You are capable. He believes in you, and he wants to do incredible things in your life. It is time for each and every single one of us to look in the mirror and find the underdog hidden within each of us. And so I'll leave you with this. May you listen for God's call. May you start to look at your life without comparison. Look at your life by heaven's standards, and then respond with obedience, and may the world never be the same.